Thank you so much. Okay. So hopefully you can hear me in the back. Okay. Thank you for that warm welcome and for the invitation. The hospitality has been wonderful, and I don't think I have spoken or presented in a more historic setting. This is a wonderful room. I could really get used to it. It makes my classrooms back in Rochester look pretty shabby indeed. Normally when I give a talk on Bermuda in February, it's to a kind of shivering, snowbound northern crowd, and I could say, take your mind back and go to tropical Bermuda with me. But the weather we had today and yesterday is, you got nothing on Bermuda. I think it's warmer here than in St. George's. So I want to start with what I hope is a familiar story, the founding of South Carolina. And kind of talk through, maybe refresh your memory, how it is usually going down in textbooks and in most people's minds today. So we all know about the seven proprietors and the fact that South Carolina, or the Carolinas, was granted in 1663, but it took till 1669 for two particular proprietors, Anthony Ashley Cooper, Earl of Shaftesbury, and Sir John Colleton, both with Barbadian connections, to really jumpstart and get this project going. They gathered a fleet of three ships, and they sent it to Ireland to pick up some settlers, as well as the English settlers. And then they went to Barbados to pick up some additional settlers for this new colony. And I say Murphy's Law because it seems whenever you got a mission with three ships, going back to Columbus, something's going to go wrong with this. A lot went wrong with this particular voyage. They went to Barbados, and in November, one of their ships sank in a storm with almost all hands. Then they got their act together, and they were sailing on. And at Abaco, another of their ships went up on a reef and was sunk and taken out. The remaining vessel, the Carolina, instead of going on with its much diminished fleet, put into Bermuda, I guess, to regroup and repair. And the Bermuda story here, Bermudians, when they heard about this, that this was nothing new to them. Bermuda's own history started with a shipwreck. A Virginia-bound, Virginia Company fleet ship, the Sea Venture, wrecked on Bermuda's reef in 1609, starting the colony settlement off. Also, the accounts of that inspired William Shakespeare's Tempest. So shipwrecks were commonly associated with starting colonies in Bermudians' mind. Bermuda in this story that you're all familiar with is an anomaly. The vessel pulls in, the shipwreck guys from the Bahamas regroup and catch up with the vessel in Bermuda. They recruit William Sale, this elderly gentleman who becomes South Carolina's first governor, and they carry on, and they in April they get to the Ashley Cooper River. They settle Old Charleston, 1670 Albemarle Point, and Sale lasts for about a year, and then he dies. And then, for the next decades on, the Barbadians, who are very much a part of this process, kind of lead and shape the colony in their way, eventually heading towards rice, plantation, slavery, the facets that emerge, facets in South Carolina history, which are very similar to Barbados history. Oftentimes, the Bahamas, which get picked up by six of the seven proprietors, is added, but never really connected very well. It just seems the same backers obtain the Bahamas charter as well. So this is laudable in that this Eugene Sermons, Jack Green, and Richard Dunn were alerting us to this in the early 70s. These are really early instances of an Atlantic history and an Atlantic perspective that are linking, not just telling a transatlantic story of immigration and English settlement, but a circumatlantic or an intercolonial connection. My problem in working with Bermuda history is that this story is really quite incomplete. It's not to say that Barbados is not very important, but there are many more connections. So my talk tonight will be about linking Bermuda and the Bahamas much more authentically and importantly to this South Carolina history early on. Through Anthony Ashley Cooper, the Earl of Shaftesbury, sort of the Kevin Bacon with the 6 degrees of separation of this Atlantic world. I've also argued that Bermuda plays an extremely important role in the first decade of South Carolina's history and well into the 18th century, leads to its early, quick, and successful settlement. I also study Virginia and Jamestown, and boy, does the first 10 years of South Carolina look a whole lot different from the first 10 years, 15 years of Jamestown, which was an unmitigated disaster. And I think learning lessons from the past and having experienced American colonists and good supply lines made all the difference. And that's where the Bermudian importance comes in. And I'm finally also going to talk a little bit about some tangible links that we can see to this day between a bit of Bermuda in South Carolina, a bit of South Carolina I've recently found in Bermuda. And then if time allows and I have some time, I would love to share with you some of the kind of the future of the past, the digital project I'm working on, and some of the implications of what you might think about doing here in South Carolina using new digital computer modeling technology. So, let's return to that 1670 moment. Let's return, not just have Bermuda as this little brief stop on the way to the real story, but let's take Bermuda and take stock of Bermuda when the Carolina arrives in February 1670. What is Bermuda like? We know a lot about what Barbados was like and why people left there for the Carolinas, but what about Bermuda? Bermuda, as you can see here, just as a matter of scale, it's about 16 miles from end to end, and never really more than a mile wide. Bermuda is a tiny place in a vast ocean, 600 miles from the Outer Banks, the nearest point of land. Very isolated, very small, out in the Atlantic, surrounded by reef and a lot of deep water. These 20 square miles, though, in 1670 were home to about 7,000 people. This was a population that South Carolina would not achieve until about 1705, 35 years before South Carolina became as crowded as Bermuda was at the dawn of its settlement. This is probably the most densely populated colony in English America. Barbados was the other, perhaps, rival, but it had a much larger population on 166 square miles. Bermuda's economy was based on, got ahead of myself. So again, restoring Bermuda to South Carolina's history through Anthony Ashley Cooper. So Bermuda, 1670, very crowded. Its economy started, its early economic success came from tobacco. The Sea Venture shipwreck castaways actually found Spanish tobacco growing there, a high-grade, saleable European commodity-grade tobacco, as opposed to Native American tobacco of North America, which was not cultivatable. John Rolfe was one of the Sea Venture shipwrecks. I'm pretty sure that John Rolfe's tobacco in Virginia actually came from Bermuda. We have archaeological evidence that they were in fact smoking tobacco while they were shipwrecked there, including Rolfe. The thing about the Bermudians, though, is they grew this tobacco that they found there, and they couldn't cure it initially. They had to bring in Hispanic African slaves from the Caribbean who taught them to cure tobacco in the Spanish manner, which produced a shiny, black, rolled, or twisted product. And so this is very distinct from the tobacco that Barbados and Virginia exported, which was a sort of a loose leaf bundle sort of arrangement and curing. So Africans arrived in Bermuda in 1616, 3 years before Virginia. But they were brought here for their expertise in pearl diving, in cultivating various Caribbean crops, and in curing tobacco. So it was really their brains, not their brawn, that brought slaves to Bermuda at this time. The problem with tobacco was that by the 1630s, 40s, Virginia was producing millions of pounds of this stuff, and the price of tobacco collapsed. So Bermudians by 1670 had diversified their economy. They were commercial fishing, they were raising corn, they were raising livestock, they were had a dairying industry, they were distilling rosewater perfume. They were making shoes, tanning leather. They actually had an economy that looked a whole lot like New England, of all places. They grew tobacco still, but they had this incredibly diverse range of household production. And that was very important. The island also was, basically it was a land of small farms, small family-operated farms. The island had been surveyed into these long, narrow 25-acre shares or strips, each one with a family. Then they were worked, their tobacco and various productions. It was mostly child, white children labor, household labor with some slaves, all living in the same household or nearby. There is no plantation economy there. The island is too crowded, and it's very early starts with a small farm, small unit arrangement here. African slaves by 1670 were perhaps a quarter of the population, a population of 1,500 or so African descended slaves. There's no African slave trade. They are not being brought directly from Africa to Bermuda. They're arriving largely on privateers via the Caribbean during the colonial wars. But most of the black Bermudians by 1670 are island-born, probably 70 to 80% by that time. So the island population is white and black families, multi-generational families, because this island is a very healthy place. High birth rates, no endemic diseases, diversified diets. That's how it got so crowded so quickly. Now, Bermuda, though, is not all a very crowded paradise. On the one hand, you have this many people. You don't have opportunities for your children because there's only so many ways you can divide up a 25-acre farm among your two, three, four sons. Bermuda also had a very turbulent religious background. Bermuda was Puritan from the start. Before we get a Puritan New England, we have a Puritan Bermuda. 1612, 8 years before the Mayflower Compact, the first settlers of Bermuda enter into a religious covenant to make a Christian commonwealth there. So this island has a strong religious character right from the start. Again, one of the very first buildings built is St. Peter's Church, which if you visit Bermuda, you can go to St. George's and you can attend a service in a church building that has been continuously used since 1612, more than 400 years of worshiping in the same spot. So intensely Puritan in the 1630s, and in the 1640s, the turbulence comes when you have kind of moderate Puritans and really militant separating Puritans, very exclusive, independent Puritans. And so the island is very religious, but it splits. And in that year, 1647, the most radical people are basically expelled. And this is where William Sale comes in. William Sale was the governor of Bermuda, 1641 to 46. He is actually a moderate Puritan. He believes in religious toleration, kind of like a Roger Williams, thinks nobody quite knows the path to salvation. So we should allow everybody to find that. So William Sale gets a charter for the Bahamas to settle it as a place of religious toleration, anticipating what happens with Cooper and Locke in South Carolina. So he gets this charter in 1647 for the Bahamas and plants a colony called Eleuthera or Liberty. And it ironically is two sales tolerant colony that the most intolerant militant Puritans who get kicked out of Bermuda go and settle. Now the Sale family, William Sale and his three seafaring sons, basically develop the Bahamas as kind of a personal family proprietary colony where people are catching turtles and catching fish and salvaging wrecks. But the Bahamas is really the Sale family's colony up through 1660, when Charles II is restored as king, and all of the colonies made before then, they're annulled. So the Bahamas becomes in a state of limbo. Sale would like to claim it and had developed it, but the charter had lapsed, and this was in a no man's land of sorts. The most important thing, though, in 1670 is that Bermudians were at war with their parent company. The Somers Island Company, which was a joint stock company based in London. So think Microsoft or IBM or a corporation running a colony. That's what the Somers Island Company is. And their symbol has, you know, a shipwreck on it, quite fittingly. So during the English Civil War, the Somers Island Company members were split between royalists and parliamentarians, and the chaos of the 1640s and 50s, really, the company board of trustees, if you will, or board of executives, pretty much didn't meet for about 15 years. And during this period, this is when Bermudians dropped tobacco and diversified their economy, and really started trading with other nearby colonies. All the American colonies were kind of left on their own during the domestic troubles there, and they had to come up with their own domestic production and trade with each other to survive. And this is what Bermudians do. They start to build ships, they start to trade with Barbados and other colonies at this time, and they grow food locally to trade to either passing ships, or they build their own ships and they take this food to other colonies to sell there. This is how and why they're able to shift away from exclusive tobacco focus. And William Sale and his three sons, and his three sons-in-law, who are also mariners, are leading traders in the 1660s at this time, with big Atlantic multi-colonial connections. This is also a period of Bermudian exodus. Bermuda's crowded, really, from the 1630s on. And there's always, for younger sons and poorer families, a lack of opportunity. So from the 1620s on, Bermudians are leaving the island for Virginia, for Barbados, for an island called Old Providence off the Nicaragua coast, St. Lucia, Trinidad, Tobago, Jamaica. There's a long tradition of Bermudians leaving and starting new colonies at the very outset. That's a long established thing, because a new colony can give you many more acres of land than ever you could hope to achieve or even rent back home in Bermuda, because all the land had been taken up. A lot of these colonies failed, but still Bermudians, crowded Bermuda, persisted. And so in 1660, the monarchy is restored, English economics are stabilized, and the Somers Island Company reconvenes, is reconstituted. And when they meet, they don't like what they've seen. They don't like what their colony has become. And so they attack both the diversified economy as well as the emigration from the island. Basically, what the Somers Island Company wants to do is turn back the clock to the 1620s, because the Somers Island Company can't tax or profit from either Bermudians leaving or Bermudians trading with other colonies. There's no way to basically, you know, capture or measure that. So what the company wants them to do, this now crowded island, they want everybody to go back to growing only tobacco, because the tobacco is something they can tax. They put a penny a pound tax on tobacco, and they say all tobacco has to come get shipped in the company's vessel so they can make money on freight. So the Bermuda Company sends a big ship, one big ship each year, which is going to take on all the Bermudians' tobacco, which then they can tax and take their cut of it. The other thing about this ship is Bermudians are only supposed to buy European goods which are shipped on the ship. So it's a company store. It's a floating company store that sells at the company's set prices, and the Bermudians are supposed to have no option but to pay those prices. So the farmer might pay his taxes and his rent, and then to buy his necessities, the whole rest of his year's tobacco growth is going to go to buying, you know, the hammers and the cloth and the things that he needs for this. So the company really basically wants to isolate Bermuda, make it a captive, enforce a monopoly on it. And the way you do this is by taking apart that diversified economy, especially taking away Bermudians' access to markets abroad. So the company, in the early 1660s, bans non-company licensed, i.e. every other ship, from arriving and trading in Bermuda. They also outlaw shipbuilding. An island 600 miles from anywhere out in the middle of the Atlantic is now not supposed to have any ships. The Atlantic is supposed to be a prison, not a highway for these people. And it's only by creating the situation that the company can make 6,000-7,000 people economic captives and profit from this. So this is the war that is going on when the Carolina fetches up in 1670. You have a large population of skilled but frustrated settlers. They have strong moral and Puritan characteristics, and they have a slave tradition that is quite old, but is really based on slaves being skilled workers rather than, you know, doing interchangeable agricultural work. And you have a lot of white and black Bermudian integration. Slaves are owned in small numbers by many households in this society. So when the Carolina is there in St. George's and is coming with some English settlers and Barbadian settlers who are recruited, and they are meeting Bermudians who are in this state, in this crowded state, in this frustrated state. Ironically, there was a lot of Bermuda trade with Barbados, so it could well be that many of these Barbadians who had been recruited to go to South Carolina actually knew and maybe in some ways were related to the Bermudians that they interacted with there in early 1670. Now, William Sale was age 80 at the time, and he was very wealthy. We don't have a picture of him, but we have a picture here on the map of one of his mansion. There were 12 mansions listed on a 1663 survey. The Sale family had one of them. His sons were also very wealthy as well. So a huge question I have is, why did this 80-year-old guy come out of retirement and do this very dangerous thing out in a brand new frontier? So a couple things we can think about. On the one hand, he might have actually known Anthony Ashley Cooper. So this might be something of a favor. Sale had been in London, maybe perhaps in getting the Eleuthera Charter, Cooper had figured in and helped him out. So there might be that connection. A second might be a sense of duty, perhaps even religious duty. He might have seen the hand of Providence in this vessel arriving with this mission. Because he was also one of the handful of people in the entire Atlantic world who had on his CV starting a whole colony from scratch. He had done this in Eleuthera, now he could do this again in South Carolina. He was a man who knew the challenges and the problems that's, you know, managing colonists in a new environment, exploring a new environment, getting an economy up and running. He knew these the ways that most people only knew him, perhaps theoretically. I think perhaps, though, of all these things, maybe some of these are at play, but I think Sale was doing it for his sons. Because again, Bermuda was a limited place. The Sale sons, mariners, could get a bit of land, inherit dad's, you know, 50 acres or so. But in Carolina, he could secure much larger lands and have a much bigger future for his sons, the next generation, through his service. Now, before we even get to Carolina, William Sale joining this expedition is important. Sir John Yeaman's, Anthony Cooper's designate governor, he basically, after two shipwrecks, he throws up his hands and he quits. So the whole colony is about to basically come to a dead stop when Sale volunteers. But when Sale volunteers, he gives this mission credibility and a second wind. More importantly, a lot of Bermudians say, well, if William Sale is leading this, sign me up too. And a couple dozen Bermudians probably join that first fleet. And second thing is, William Sale buys a Bermuda sloop. Bermuda sloop may not seem like a big deal, but it plays a crucial role in the first 2 years of the colony. These vessels, with a single mast, they're very maneuverable. They have a very light, shallow draft. They're very fast vessels. So they're perfect for exploring a riverine environment. Don't forget, these people are arriving in a Carolina that is only vaguely known. they sort of have to map and figure out the geography of the place even as they settle it. It reminds me of John Smith in Jamestown in 1608-9 making his map of the Chesapeake Bay. You're settling as well as just figuring out where you are in the world simultaneously. So he buys this Bermuda sloop, and probably his son sails it, accompanies the fleet, the Carolina, to the Americas. This is also, by the way, during this period in Bermuda, while sail is being recruited, those castaways in the Bahamas, those English and Barbadian people, Recta, Nabucco, reach Bermuda and regroup and rejoin. And some of them undoubtedly travel on the Bermuda sloop, which provides extra berths to even just get this group to South Carolina for the first time. They depart in February, arrive 17 days later. 2 weeks passage, think about that. 2 weeks sail or thereabouts between Bermuda and South Carolina. So in terms of supplying, maintaining, helping in terms of aid, Bermuda as essentially the backstop for Carolina 2 weeks away is so much more significant than England, which is 10, 12 weeks away. And again, the long supply line between England and Virginia and the slow pace of inadequate supplies is so much responsible for the Jamestown disasters, whereas the very closeness and support of Bermuda, I'll argue, plays a critical role. So they arrive and they pick, I guess it's called Charlestown Landing now, but they set up the first town. Governor Sale chooses the place and quickly gets started. Sale himself maps and explores a lot of these rivers in his Bermuda sloop. He also establishes peaceful relations with Native Americans, which is again something that didn't happen in Jamestown and so badly hurt that colony. And here again, an 80-year-old man, we might not conceive of it, but the venerable age of Sale as he meets Kiowa and other chieftains of the coastal area, his age would be impressive in that culture and that society. It would give this sort of gravitas to this this diplomatic mission in a way that a 25 or 30-year-old guy would not, who would not be seen as an elder chief and statesman. But clashes do emerge. As I think I hopefully have put out there, Bermuda and Barbados really had distinctive American cultures by the 1670s. And William Sale's first law was against profaning the Sabbath. He might be religiously tolerant, but he wanted his population to be religious first and foremost. And the Barbadians were drunkards and sinful and contentious, and they were making his life a headache. They called him useless, they called him non compos mentis in letters, and they just wanted him out. And he only lasts about a year. In February, he's described as very weak. He dies shortly thereafter. But he succeeds. If his mission was to make his sons' lives better, he succeeds, because in his will, he leaves a mansion house. So by the summer, just a few short months of arriving, he's built a mansion house in this brand new colony. He gives that to his two sons. He gives 1,300 acres to his two sons as well. 1,300 acres is bigger than an entire parish in Bermuda. Mind-bogglingly huge expanse of property from a Bermudian perspective. In that household, in that mansion, we also have the first black South Carolinians. William Sale came over with John and Elizabeth and their son John. A fourth slave named William arrives by the summer of 1670. So enslaved Bermudians become the first African-descended immigrants to South Carolina as well. In the next 10 years, South Carolina and Bermuda links are extensive and, I would argue, critical. The first is trade and settlers. Bermuda exports settlers and supplies. They jumpstart the South Carolina economy. There's a list by Agnes Baldwin that I have identified at least 46 Bermudians and as many as 100 Bermudians who arrive before 1690. By contrast, Richard Dunn found 146 people from the West Indies, not all from Barbados either. So Bermuda's early contribution to South Carolina's population is fairly close and rivaling the entire Caribbean contribution in the first early years alone. And these, they come with valuable and diverse skills. They can grow Indian corn, they can grow cassava, they're used to herding livestock, potatoes. These are all crops that are American crops that European, French, and English later immigrants are unfamiliar with. So these people can immediately and successfully cultivate these New World crops and teach their later arrivals how to do this as well. So basically, Bermudians arrive and they replicate the smallish family farms, diversified agricultural farms that they had known back in Bermuda. Very few of them go into the large-scale plantation. That's sort of the Bermuda default, is to reconstruct this farming versus this plantation style of development. Useful skills, not only are they good farmers, but they're also mariners, they're also carpenters, shipbuilders, some of them become pilots, they're fishermen, cordwainers. In short, they have a lot of skills that for a riverine environment are pretty important. Building boats, operating boats, fishing, things to sustain this early population. As merchants, those Bermudian merchants already back in Bermuda had contacts and trading links with other colonies, and they bring that network of commercial contacts with them to early South Carolina. So South Carolina's earliest intercolonial trade is really being in part powered by these skilled Bermudian merchants. Bermuda is also bringing their distinctive tobacco cultivation techniques. The early accounts of the tobacco exports from South Carolina talk about them being like the Spanish, or cured in the Spanish manner. So they're not learning this from Barbados, and they're not copying anybody in Virginia. This is basically the Bermudians are transferring and replicating their tobacco tradition of cultivation here on Carolina shores. Bermudians are also weaving palmetto plait into hats and baskets. We get some records of teaching their neighbors and doing this again in, with the South Carolina state tree. Imports, the trade I mentioned as being vital to sustaining this colony. Bermudians make 7 round-trip voyages between Bermuda and South Carolina between 1670 and 1673. The very dawn of the colony, when it matters most, it's a shuttle trade back and forth between Bermuda, or in some cases, Bermudian ships are shuttling between Barbados and South Carolina. The first summer, they arrive with 30 barrels of flour and 4,000 pounds of beef. So before South Carolina farms even got up, before the colony could even feed itself, it is Bermudian infusions of food that is keeping the early people alive. But in vessel after vessel, livestock, the first breeding livestock arrives from Bermuda. Seeds, cassava, potatoes, Indian corn, the things that the colonists are going to grow on their farm, the sort of basic startup toolkit for a colonist farm is also coming from Bermuda. And those early Bermuda farmers, when they get their farms up and running, they can then supply the breeding pairs and seed stock to later emigrants and arrival as they set up their farms as well. So it becomes sort of a self-fulfilling, I guess the opposite of a vicious cycle, a positive cycle. Bermuda merchant John Darrell even directly contracts with the proprietors to supply at set prices candles, beef, fish, live cattle at set prices and set freight rates, which are half of what competing Virginia colonists were offering them. So again, infusions of necessary supplies at the very dawn of this. And these same ships, they're bringing goods, of course, but they're also conduits for, the immigration goes hand in hand. So dozens more Bermudian families, and they do tend to emigrate as families, flow into South Carolina on these trading vessels. And then the very last thing Bermudians do, and this is again an important Bahamas link, or Turks and Caicos Islands, which is just off this map. Bermudians' other sidelight was raking salt in these kind of abandoned natural salt pans on these kind of exposed barren Caribbean islands. So seawater would rush in, water would evaporate out, leave large amounts of salt, which you could rake up, put on your ship, and sell. Bermudians, through port records we see, Bermudians are supplying 40 to 60% of the salt that flows into Charleston in the early 18th century. Salt, in an age where we have no refrigeration, salt is the way you preserve things. And all of those 1,000 head of cattle that various plantations are raising, that's going to be useless come October unless you have salt as the vital material to transform live cattle into saleable meat. So Bermudian salt coming from the Bahamas and Turks Island really sustains the non-plantation or non-rice part of the South Carolina economy. Now the patterns I've seen here, and again I found and reconstructed dozens and dozens of particular Bermudians who come to South Carolina and through generations on. The patterns I find are that it's merchants, it's mariners, it's various skilled people, very few become big planters. And they basically either cluster in a larger community in James Island, or they set up in Charleston itself, either old Charleston or present-day Charleston. One of the first groups that arrive are Quakers. Quakers, there's a small group of Quakers in Bermuda in 1670, but the Puritans there are really attacking them, taxing them for every Sunday they miss church, trying to tax them into conversion, I suppose. So Quakers respond to the religious toleration that is guaranteed them here in the Carolinas. A guy named Richard Hawke, with his wife and 9 children and slave, and William Murrell, arrive in 1671. But dozens of, the Chaphams, the Wilkinsons, the Baisdens, the Rawlings, the Jennings, the Witters, if those names mean anything to you, these other Bermuda Quaker families arrive. Most of them settle in Charleston. Two of them, Charles Baisden and Edward Rawlings, marry, become the sons-in-law of probably the most famous Quaker woman in the entire Atlantic world, Mary Fisher Cross. Mary Fisher was an international missionary. She tried to convert, you know, the head of the Ottoman Empire, and had gone throughout the Caribbean and, you know, had interviews with the Pope to try to convert him at the time. And she picked Charleston to retire to in the 1690s, and two Bermudian Quakers married her daughters. So Bermudians were very prominent in the earliest Quaker meetings here. Anthony Asher Cooper personally very much liked and respected the Quakers, who he called a people I have a great regard to and am obliged to care for. He had even thought about giving a 12,000 acre sort of mini colony within the colony to the Quakers specifically to settle, but never went through with it. Or there's a kind of mysterious place called Bermuda Town, which never developed but still remains a place name on some maps that I think may have been that Quaker enclave, which was never taken up. The Charleston merchants, as I mentioned, they're among the very first owners of locally registered vessels. Bermuda merchants operating out of Charleston either bring Bermuda-built vessels here, or they build South Carolina vessels following Bermuda plans, and they operate these vessels. And they trade with the Bahamas and much of the Caribbean and up in New England. And so a local autonomous indigenous fleet is really coming out of Charleston, and it's Bermudians who are among the first businessmen doing this. And again, most of these guys are intercolonial. Some of them go big time and go into European trading. John and Benjamin Savage, I passed Savage Street driving around here earlier. John Darrell, Thomas Tucker are again bigger merchants. But Henry Lawrence, another big merchant, would often employ Bermudians who he thought were much safer, more reliable, responsible captains than other vessels. Now the James Island group, much larger, arrived and formed a very tight-knit community in the 1670s. Rivers very much stands out. A lot of them had intermarried over two, three generations. They also retained their Puritan religious congregational upbringing in that this is technically, or it becomes an Anglican colony, but these Bermudians fund with bequests and out of their own pockets a Presbyterian meeting house, which they sustained through the 18th century. Another Bermudian, actually, again, of Puritan disposition, Reverend Josiah Smith, who's kind of a merchant as well as a minister, and he is here, publishes a lot of sermons, and preaches to essentially Bermudian and Bermudian descendants, a big part of his congregation here in the 18th century. Nicholas Trott, again, the Attorney General, the Chief Justice, the guy who first codifies South Carolina's laws, is really his family. The Trott family is very connected to Bermuda. He was Bermuda's Attorney General before he moves here and does his thing. Joseph Vasey and Thomas Tudor Tucker are others, but in the interest of time, I will quickly move through them. And again, here are your James Island group and your Charleston group. Now, Anthony Ashley Cooper. Again, if you just sort of move on to Barbados after 1670, you miss the fact that Anthony Ashley Cooper, once he becomes aware of Bermuda and the vital role Bermuda plays, he basically does a hostile takeover. He becomes governor of the Bermuda Summers Island Company. He takes over the corporation, and he kind of really puts the brakes on this push to restrict intercolonial trade and Bermudian emigration, because these are, if they were left in place, they would really hurt the supplying of his South Carolina venture. So by taking over Bermuda's government and relaxing the laws for about 5 years, he allows the space between South Carolina and Bermuda to open up and really connect those two colonies. And here again, Bermudians figure into the Bahamas story too, because John Darrell, that same guy supplying contracted beef, and his buddy Hugh Wentworth, from 1666 to 1670, they basically had illegally settled the Bahamas. They had moved about 500 or 600 Bermudians to occupy various Bahamas islands. They had a thriving venture. They were busy, you know, granting out land to these newcomers, and they had no legal basis whatsoever to do any of this. So here is a colony that has no formal charter, and yet they have a lot of people on the ground. So they need some big person in England to give legitimacy and a legal standing to their settlement. So basically they offer to Anthony Ashley Cooper, please get a charter. Here's a free colony. It's already settled. 500 people. It's going to be quite a while before South Carolina gets up to that point. You know, the population of the Bahamas, 1672, is probably three times that of South Carolina. And Anthony Ashley Cooper basically does not look this gift horse in the mouth, and he gets the charter in 1671, and the Bahamas, again, are connected through salt trades. It's a free colony, it's a headache, because these Bahamians do not follow any of the proprietor's orders. I think they got the better end of the deal. Now, the last thing I wanted to talk about, two different ways where we're connecting these two places. I went around today, and I read in Jonathan Poston's book about Bermuda stone being used in early Charleston houses. I find Bermuda stone in St. Eustatius, in St. Thomas, in St. Croix, in Jamaica. I find Bermudians, when they traveled, they tended to go in a sloop with 2,000-3,000 stones. Essentially, they were bringing their future houses with them. They would migrate and they would build with stones, kind of taking a piece of the island with them, so they would always be kind of connected, I think. That's maybe romantic of me, but or you could look at it commercially that, well, you're going to sail empty in ballast. You might as well bring a ballast you can sell. So Bermuda would cut through their own native limestone, which is very soft but hardens when exposed to the air, load up sloops, and sell boatloads, sloop loads of cargo of Bermuda stone with them. And we know from shipping records that, you know, tens of thousands of stones were arriving in South Carolina year after year. So the Pink House on Chalmers Street, And most excitingly, this row, three houses on Church Street, at the end of Church Street, are some of these rare survivors. Bermuda stone and brick, again, not very flammable. So some of these houses survived the 1740 fire and subsequent fires and wars to persist to this day. What was very exciting, again, most of the time it's stuccoed over and painted. You really can't tell what's under that. Is it brick? Is it Bermuda stone, really? But these houses, 143 Church Street, the side of it is entirely exposed. And these are clearly Bermuda stone. I've seen a lot of Bermuda stone excavating in a quarry these past summers. And this is clearly Bermuda stone. So, but you know, the architecture of Charleston is so similar in appearance to Bermudian architecture. So, you know, if you didn't know this was necessarily a Bermudian house, you know, I could pick this up and probably plop it down sideways somewhere in Charleston. This is a 1670s building with the balcony and the coins and the keystones over the windows. This would totally fit right in. Whitehall here, built around 1799, with a wooden porch. Again, very typical. Even in late 18th and early 19th century sketches, you get a sense of Bermudian architecture resembling Charleston architecture. So looking at Bermuda's standing and surviving early 18th century houses may give you a sense, or be kind of a window into, how pre-1740, at least some of pre-1740 Charleston architecture might look. And as I said, it's very soft when you cut it. Here's a guy, and he's just using a saw, and you're using a saw. Cutting Bermuda stone is actually easier than cutting wood, and yet the things harden into like cinder block hardness once exposed. Now the connection that goes the other way took me a lot longer to find and comes out of this archaeological work that I'm doing. I'm basically methodically taking on an entire 60-acre island as a holistic laboratory for studying four centuries of Bermudian activity and life, white, black, especially. And I have 16, 17 different sites of different periods that I'm looking at. Oven site, so named because there's a big oven there, appears on a 1617 map. So it's one of the earliest that you can find. And we are interested, there are no timber frame Bermuda houses that have survived. So Bermuda's first century of architecture is entirely lost to us unless we investigate it archaeologically. So I chose this site to study post in the ground building and early 17th century settler life here. And I spent the last 3 years excavating here. They kind of chopped into a hillside, into the soft Bermuda bedrock, to create this kind of flat stone floor. And you could see a whole series of different post holes. We have big, deep, early post holes, and then we have smaller, rounder post holes, which I think are, this building was probably repaired over the course of a century. But one of the most intriguing things we had is a probate inventory for 1706. In a very old, you know, there was an old man, Boaz Sharp, who had a very poor household, not, you know, highly assessed. A lot of things were called old or worn out, old chair without arms. But most importantly, he listed 9 Native American slaves, 2 men, 2 women, and 5 children, which I'm thinking are 2 couples and their children. So the population of Smith's Island at the early 18th century was 10, 9 of whom were Indian Native American slaves. And again, you have detritus, and then you have occupied layers for your late 17th and your early 17th century. And it's in these layers that we found a total of about 30 chert flakes, different varieties of rock, but evidence that flint knapping or stone tool making is happening here in Bermuda. These stones, there's only one sort of stone in Bermuda, it's limestone. So these stones, the raw material is imported from somewhere, and the process of making stone tools is also a connection with these Native Americans. This is not flint, so it's not like, you know, starting a fire. This is making stone tools particularly. We also have, and here's where I suppose Carolina Native American archaeologists and experts can help me. We also have this bizarre feature cut into the north wall of the house. It's kind of a rounded, ovular, almost like a grotto, and there's a hole for a rod or a pin going deep, and another hole in the back, and then it seems like a flue or some sort of, either to bring something down in or, you know, smoke to come out. I'm really puzzled. I have no idea what this is functionally, but the documented presence of Native Americans makes me think that this is perhaps a feature related to something they're doing rather than something that English settlers are doing here. So the reason why I link this with South Carolina is the Sharp family, as you know, or as I've said, many Bermudians are trading back and forth with the Carolinas at this time. 1670s, 80s, 90s, peak of the Native American slave trade being exported out of Charleston. Bermudian vessels are carrying these slaves, mostly to Barbados and to other Caribbean islands, but some of them are coming back to Bermuda. 1690s, in the probate inventories, if you count up the race of slaves in all of the different decades of all the surviving probate inventories, 1690s, Indian as a slave identifier peaks at about 10-11%. So I don't think there's any coincidence. By the mid-18th century, Indian is kind of gone as a slave name. I think after a generation, the supply vanishes and the existing Native Americans in Bermuda intermarry with the African population and just are called Negro. But there are many non-white Bermudians who assert a Native American ancestry and are sort of right now working with DNA analysis to kind of substantiate this. But I think probably many from the broader Carolina slave trade catchment are winding up on ships and arriving there in Bermuda, 50, 100, 150 at the time. But I'm pretty sure that these four, at least, the adults, are born somewhere in North America, in the Carolinas, and arriving from Bermuda, and the children are born here. Through the wonders of GIS, you can model and create kind of, think of a video game where you can kind of walk through and play and interact with things. My goal is to build a historic version of this, a laboratory, and you can start with a modern image with the footprints, the digital footprints of buildings. And then you could overlay historic maps onto this, which are going to tell you of the buildings around today, which one actually dates that far back in time. The purple houses, for instance, on this are the ones that can that go back at least as far as this 1854 map. You could see some gray buildings, which are buildings which were there in 1854, which have vanished over time. So you can even reconstruct buildings that are so quote unquote lost. Here's an example. Here's just a ruin, a hole in the ground. But you can take measurements from it, as an architect would. There's a picture of the ruin as standing, the shell of the building. And you could put it into a CAD or a computer in 2D, and then the program could generate what this building would have looked like standing in its glory back in the 18th century. So you're seeing something, a site, a rendering that nobody has seen in the last 80 years when this building fell to pieces. More importantly, you could take a probate inventory which lists the things you had room by room when you died, this case in 1715, and you could furnish this reconstructed building with the tables, the chairs, the beds, the material culture that would have been there. So you can kind of walk through this house as we think it could be furnished, you know, three and a half, two, 3 centuries ago, or whenever your probate is. And you can get these kind of snapshots too, so you can interact with the objects. You can do on an individual house by house basis, you could put the whole thing together and model in terms of topography the entire town. This is a very coarse, just pulling up the footprints of buildings to be blocks. But each of these blocks gets replaced with a precisely rendered individual house over time. And here's kind of an image. You can do it flat, and you can do it kind of in a panorama. So there's a 19th century photo blending in, or the shapes on the photo inform how you can change the digital, the 3D model that is in place. And then the ultimate step is to take this kind of 3D world that you've built, move it into video game software, and turn people loose. Add characters, add artificial intelligence avatars dressed in period outfits. I can imagine, you know, cattle and hogs and chickens running around in the streets and dirt, and you can set wind in motion. You know, you can hit the town with a hurricane, model a hurricane, what would happen to the town, which we know happened. And you can populate this town and make it like a school field trip that would be something a fourth grader would want to go on. And you could, again, because we know who lived in which house with how many children and how many slaves and their names, as you navigate this town, you could walk up to people, you could ask them questions, they could tell you their stories, and you could really learn history by you interacting with them rather than kind of a very static lecture. So each person can be their own detective and their own historian. Now here's what I find, just a quick taking stock. I've already been working and talking with the people at Drayton Hall who, again, because you don't have a furnished space, but you can digitally and virtually furnish this, and you can digitally and virtually reconstruct Drayton Hall, you know, at 1760 and 1790 and 1820, because you have a huge expanse of important history that you're covering there. You can bring people into that world at different historic moments and interact with them. But let's not stop there. One thing, again, to suggest is all of Charleston you could do this for. We have this wonderful 1704 map. We have the walls in place. Even better, you have this wonderful 1739 map, fortunately done just on the eve of a big fire that suddenly changes the landscape, but showing the building footprints, where to pull up these sort of modeled houses. You've done huge amounts of research. The Poston book I really enjoy reading, and you have kind of this deed chain, and you know so much about the people living in these individual properties. You have property lines, you have house footprints, a lot of past historic research, and again, you can bring this, you can digitally reconstruct, say, Charleston on the eve of the 1740 fire. And not only do you have maps, but again, you can study 3D approximations of what these houses look like, because you have this kind of prospect in the scene. And I would say, not only just don't stop at the streets, go out into the Ashley and the Cooper River and put some sloops and put some vessels there too. Have the sort of Atlantic traffic that would be coming and going. So there's tremendous potential to recover lost Charlestons. Because you have a lot of documentary work to work with. Now, I'm busy with St. George's, so it's not going to be necessarily me who does this, but this is to plant the seed and hopefully get some people excited. And you have a whole life of studying ahead of you, and maybe this is going to be your job. Class project. So just think about it. And again, kind of an immersive digital experience that can go hand in hand with walking the real streets of Charleston and then visiting the ancient streets of Charleston in your computer. And finally, the long version, not that this wasn't a long version, but the longer version of all of these connections and kind of Bermuda's Atlantic networking and integration, a lot of this has been drawn from my book, In the Eye of All Trade, which is available in paperback. And I do want to thank you for your interest, for your attendance, for your patience, and especially thank you to the Drayton Hall staff who've been, you know, the epitome of Southern hospitality.
Well done. Well done.
Time for just a very few questions. So if anyone's burning with a question, please raise your hand and ask Michael. sir.
Yes. So I have that written down. I'm still learning my South Carolina geography. I think it's about 12 or 14 miles upriver from here. So it was kind of mentioned in 1699, and it's kind of referred to, I guess there was maybe a school there in the 1730s or 40s. But it's kind of, they laid it out, you know, if they build it, but nobody came. So it was an idea. It was intentional, or I think this grant was something like, if you can put 30 people on the land within 2 years, then the grant is awarded. So it was a conditional thing. The conditions were never met, so the name stuck, but the town actually never emerged. Yes?
How much does your book cost, and where can we get it?
Okay, so the book is sort of list priced at $35. I think Amazon will usually knocks 10 or 15 or 20% of that, so high 20s is pretty typical. It's University of North Carolina Press, if that doesn't dissuade you. Oh, I have a... Okay.
Why do you think the colonists died during the project?
And
what do you think?
Jamestown.
Could you repeat the question?
So, Maris in the front row wants to know why Jamestown was such a disaster. And, you know, 90% of the people who went to Jamestown died between 1607 and 1625. So it really was a disaster of unprecedented proportions. Some of it was the fact that they lived on a stretch of the river where it was tidal. So they were basically drinking the water and also throwing out their trash. And the river was never flushed away. So partly was they were poisoning themselves with salt and getting dysentery. A lot of it had to do with the fact that there were two major wars with the Powhatan Indians at the time. People died in the war, but people just had to pull back into Jamestown. They couldn't cultivate the fields around Jamestown because they would get shot. So there was, you know, terrible famine. The starving time resulted even in cannibalism. They were eating each other. They were that desperate. They went from 600 people in 1609 to about 60 people by the spring of 1610. Let's see, other reasons, a lot of mismanagement. It was also mostly guys. It was like 80, 90% guys, young indentured servant men who did not I think the lack of women who were your caregivers and you cooking and supplying medical needs and stabilizing the population, the heavy male population led to a lot of unhealthy practices, sometimes overworking. So it was really a disaster. There was a shipment of bad beer, and it was spelled B-E-A-R. So I was reading as a grad student about this bear killing dozens and dozens of people. I thought, what's going on in Jamestown? But basically kind of a toxic shipment of beer. They all broke open, they all drank it, and many of them promptly got sick and died thereafter. So it was just terrible, and it's remained terrible into the 1640s and 50s. There's a study in 1635 of 6,000 people arriving as settlers that year. A quarter to a third of them were dead within a year because the frontier existence was just really, really bad. Malaria, they were living in a pitch and tar swamp with lots of bugs. So yeah, they picked about the very worst place they could to park their colony.
Thank you so much. Okay. I really appreciated everything. It's been wonderful. Thank you so much.